I would like to kindly draw your attention to the podium, to our distinguished speakers of this panel session. I'm going to introduce a clinician turned out to be a very practical, very influential public health leader in our country, whose name is Professor Dr. Praveen Mishra. Since the day he joined the Ministry of Health, I have been watching Professor Mishra from a distance, little bit getting involved with him, and he has done miraculous contributions to move forward the basic health, the public health, and the achievement of Millennium Development Goal of 2015. So I would like to very briefly, because I have been told to go very briefly, so I will just cite few examples what he has done. Of course, he is a medical doctor, he is a welder, he did the graduation from Bombay University, and Manipal Academy for Higher Education, he did orthodontics, doctor of fellowship, doctoral fellowship, all it goes, too many things there. So I don't want to go take your time on that. As Ministry of Health, you know, Secretary of the Ministry of Health, he received on behalf of the Ministry of Health, in which I had also contributed, an award for reducing maternal mortality, for excellent progress in MDG in five achieving universal access to reproductive health, which I had started long time ago in my younger days. And then he went, in the financing in the health sector. And the three antenatal, he made it mandatory for three antenatal postnatal checkups in his time. He also made it reduce the home-based delivery and maternal death. I mean, he facilities, you know, he started that. And you see, a free distribution of iron and calcium tablets, which are not only for women of reproductive age, also for women like me, we need it. So he was very advanced in thinking. So with all these things, I would like to introduce you today, you know, Praveen, Dr. Praveen Mishra. Welcome him with big hands. Thank you.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for your excellent introduction. Without taking much time, I would proceed with my presentation. My presentation is partly on my experience as a policymaker, partly how we have tried to move forward during the implementation and the challenges that has come forward, especially for the finance. So my topic today is the health research and finance in the federal health system in Nepal. You know, a lot of most of the time we are in transition. When the democracy came, it was a transitional democracy. When the republic came, it was a republic, transition republic. Now the constitution has come, we are in the transition of the constitution. So in this transitional phase, we need to move forward with the limited resources what we have, and the challenges is that how we can well implement what we have and what we have preserved till now. So the healthcare financing for efficient and the effective healthcare to all, and especially to the poor and the marginalized and the vulnerable people. Now that is where the challenge is, how we can reach to those unreached population. Now when we talk about the vulnerability of the population and reaching to the unreached, how best we can have the health research and its finance, especially in relation to its function, so that the collaboration, the collection of revenue for equality and efficiently raising sustainable revenues to support the health care. Now, we have every time when we talk about the physical space, the financial physical space in the total budget what the Ministry of Health has received. And it is never as per our expectation or what the government has signed as a signatory in the international communities. So there is the major challenge what we have. We are always lack of finances. So what are the ways to risk pooling in an efficient and equitable manner to ensure the financial protection? Now with the limited physical space that what we have, how we can best pool the risk and prove our objective, prove our goal in the time to come. And purchasing services in an allocatively and technically efficient manner. What I mean here, allocatively is the right thing, the correct intervention, and technically efficient is in the right way, right process, right procedures. So these are the two major things with the functions that I would like to stress on. Now, when we talk about the health financing functions, we need to see the population, the collection of the fund from the populations, then it is the pooling of the fund. Pooling of the fund for the better health care. Now, pooling from the government sector, pooling from the stakeholders of the international communities in working in the health sectors, pooling the fund from the local resources or the domestic resources, how best we can really see that that thing can be pulled so that we have enough money in order to have a good research. If we have a good research with the good financing, we will have good evidence to support for the good healthcare. And for that matter, we need for the purchasing of the service for the people, even at the grassroots level and at all level. And then we can decide when we purchase the service, how best we can cover most of the services. What are the services? Basic services, specialized services, or the super specialty services we can cover among for the population. So that is going to help us in the health financing function and to see that that is the objective we should take. Depending upon this chart, what you have seen, now we need to see the goals. We need to define the goals where we should. So, ensuring the financial protection for all kinds of financial protection in the health sector, whether it is a preventive, promotive, curative, and rehabilitative. So the financial protection at all level with these four things that we need to ensure, promoting a more equitable distribution of the burden of financing. It should not be like that one who can pay, they will be well served with the service in the hospital in comparison to who cannot pay. No, it should be equitable. Equally, the service should be available to the people. There where we supposed to work for. It is not on the pocket. So the universality of the healthcare, universal healthcare has to be there. Then promoting the equitable use of the services. The government has given the service, but it has not been well utilized. We need our research focused on that, how best we can reach with the equitable service. Due to the lack of knowledge, lack of practice, lack of behavior, these things have not been translated into reality. Though it is there, availability is there, accessibility is there, but because they are not aware or the government mechanics has not been able to really make them aware about the situation over there. Then the rewarding good quality care and providing incentives for efficiency in service. You know, we all bring everything, everybody on the same board, irrespective of how good or how bad the job is being performed. So incentivize the program, incentivize the personality, incentivize the workers who are really working hard for the nation at the grassroots level to the top level. We need to incentivize, then the final output starts coming. And promoting administrative efficiency means we should minimize the duplication work. We should see that one loop should work for the health financing, not the multiple loop in the name of social health, in the name of cross-cutting issue. Ministry of Health, if they are responsible, they should be the only responsible agency for health financing, for its research or for the health services. Now, what should be the health research in the federal system? As I said, we are always in the transition. Definitely this time also we are in transition. So in the transition phase, how we should move forward? We should develop the federal health research system in aligning with the national health research system and also to the policies of the central and the provincial to the governments. There should be a well alignment. There should be well aligned policies and implementation from the center to the province to the local level. Some work has to be done at the local level more efficiently, more beneficially. That should be done there, not at the central level. So there has to be a well coordinated and well interconnected in relation to the implementation and the policy level. Decentralize and expand the role of Nepal Health Research Council in the provincial level. Here, now I think we need to really work very hard, develop or generate the evidence. Why? Now, Nepal is a country where now almost everywhere except one or two states, I think we have a very good academic institutions available. How we can align the Health Research Council with the academic institutions so that they can be of real benefit to the nation in developing the local policy and how best that the strategy can be developed in order to implement it. Allocate the health research fund each province by the federal government. And equally, the budget has to be trickled down from the center to the province as well. And province should see that how best the implementation can be at the local level. Identification of the research priority areas as per the federal structure of the country, as per the population, as per the need and the demand of the particular state. It cannot be one for all. Depending upon the situation of particular state, burden of diseases, and according to that, the distribution of the finance, distribution of the human resources, and the distribution of allocation of the offices that needs to be done. And again, it should be well interconnected so that the final outcome at the central level is giving the whole picture of the nation. Though at the provincial level, it could be different picture for different province, but it should be well interconnected at the central level so that the final picture will talk for all the provinces and all the states where the Nepal Health Research Council need to put forward their nose and just find out. Conduct health and the medical research in order to address the various dimensions of the health system. Now, as I said, we are having the changing health system. We are in transition, but this transition, we have opportunity as well as the challenge. Now, how best we could move forward and to see that this challenge is translated into a good opportunity. So, having said so, we need to advance the health research evidence. Now, once we have health research evidence, it is much easier to develop the policy. It is much easier to identify or allocate the finance, and it is much easier to implement the strategy and develop the strategy as well. So, to provide a guiding vision for the development of our health system, which is in transition, we call. So for that matter, we need to have a very guiding vision where we want to go. And for that matter, the advancing the health research is very much important, and also to come up the evidence for it. Without the evidence, we cannot move forward. Increasing healthcare demand is being transformed by the innovation into reality. So what the evidence we have generated with our innovative approach, shall we leave it in the rack? No, we need to work on it and translate those evidence into reality so that the people are benefited out of it. Most of the time, most of the incentives, if you see, very cost-effective research has a very excellent, it has the result given. I have the experience of chlorhexidine, nitomalam, which was very, very less evidence, very less cost involved in it, but the result it could brought by nearly 26% of the neonatal mortality brought down. Excellent. We need to go for that cost-effective measure. There where we should be. And until you really translate that evidence into the reality, or you dare to translate the evidence into reality, we will not be moving forward, or we will not be keeping pace with our other countries, or for the betterment of the people. Health and medical research, that is the integral part of the health system. So, the research-informed healthcare, what I mean, that is the exactly example of the research-informed healthcare, means the chlorhexidine, what it was cost-effective, very time-effective intervention or the research it was, but the impact what it was, what an excellent impact it brought. So, or the you can say for the diarrhea, the zinc tablet, vitamin A program, iron, and madam said iron and the calcium, these are the excellent intervention. So not necessary research means we need to have a big talk, big things. We can have a research with the day-to-day activities and the day-to-day things that what we are doing. So the research-informed healthcare is the research leaders, is to produce the research leader. We need to have a research leader from ourselves and as well as the research culture. We need, now our academia, the situation analysis of the nation compulsorily has to be included in the academic program so that they should know. It is not respiratory system only or the cardiovascular system. It is the system, overall national system, that it is impact, it is creating an impact. And for that matter, the academic institutions should come forward. NHRC should also has to break the ice in order to move forward to include it in the as a health research. Likewise, the transdisciplinary collaboration. What I mean here, transdisciplinary collaboration, health in all policy. Without that, we cannot achieve all the objectives and the goals what we laid down. It should be in with the Ministry of Finance, it should be with the Ministry of Industry, Ministry of Physical Planning, because the work peoples are involved in that, with that ministry, we are responsible for their health also. And it comprises of a big number. Otherwise, the nation cannot be healthy and our policy will not be successful. Then the prevent the disease and create the healthcare of the future. It is well understood. Translate the research into the better health outcome. I have already talked. Take our research and health research services expert to the world. What we have learned. Nepal is the leader in some of the initiative. We should make that initiative available for the rest of the world also, so that they can use that evidence. They can use that experience and implement in their place so that the people is getting benefit out of it. And the Nepal is well recognized for that initiative, for that particular thing. So, having this sort of overall picture, how the NHRC and the health research in the federal context should work. Given the overall a broad picture with those things, now how the NHRC should work? It should have a structural changes, not only at the center. First of all, it should have a very good provincial structure as well. And there, not the structure should not be the same as the center. There has to be a different structure, which is of more evidence generating from the grassroots level. I will be just coming, what are the things that at the grassroots level, how we should move forward. Research regulation. There has to be some regulation also, so that the people who are into the research, they should not move away from the basic ethics of the research. The basic ethics of the research needs to be well followed by the regulation and with the regulatory authority. Evidence generation at the provincial level. Now that's what I talked about. We need some evidence so that with that evidence, we can translate our product into the reality for the betterment of the people. And evidence synthesis and the utility of the product. And finally, there has to be a good capacity building. We need a training. We always see one culture we have seen, everything to be outsourced. No. I was not convinced when I was as a health secretary. I tried to do, though it was very difficult. But I prefer to go for the own capacity building, do the job own, because tomorrow, if you outsource, the people do the job, they go away. When you track them, they are no more available. So how the thing was done, you don't know. What was the reliability? You don't know. Now, when we have our own capacity, it is good for the future and we can track them. So the capacity generation of the human resources and of the people is also equally important. Now, when we talk about the evidence in the health system and financing as well, I think we cannot forget to say that the more money for health is needed. Now, the more money means we need to raise the resources for the health. For what? For the better universal health coverage. Universal health coverage has a very broad meaning, and the meaning differs from person to person, place to place, and country to country. But what we in Nepal, our context, the universal health coverage, it's simple, and we need at least basic health service to the people at all level. So the universality of the services has to be there, and the perception of the people has to be there for the better perception. Ensuring a fair share of total government spending on health, as I said, well, we are left with a very small physical space. We need at least 5% of the total GDP and 10% of the total national budget. But no, hardly 50%. Now, we need to be innovative. What we have, we need to spend in such a way that cost-effective measures and the result outcome is near to that 100% with the cost-effective measures. There where we need the research to be done. Health financing research is needed. Health economists, they should come forward. And in this, I think this is their story since last 30 years. The budget, the physical space that is given is not enough. And the budget, always we have to beg to the Ministry of Finance when we go. And finally, there is a hue and cry. Why? Because we don't have a very robust health financing system. We need to have a very robust health finance system so that we should be able to translate our need into reality with the given amount of budget, and we should have a always contingency plan for it so that we can move forward. As well, we need to diversify the domestic resource of the revenue. We have not thought of the domestic resources. We always think of the central budget. There are plenty of resources available at the grassroots level, at the public to the grassroots level, but we have not been able to explore it. I think the time has come and there is a need for the research so that we can move forward and see that. Oh, I think I'm just 2 minutes. Anyway, so these are the things. Now I must say, universal health coverage and the health financing, when we talk, we have three dimensions. Number one is the population. We want to cover 100% of the population. Number two is the services. What are the services that we want to purchase? What were the services that we want to deliver? So the area of the services that needs to be taken into consideration. And third dimension is the cost. how much cost, 100% of the cost the government will bear, or there will be the out-of-pocket expenditure as well. Lack of time again. Then more health for money. That was the more money for health. This is the more health for money. Means if you are healthy, you have a good evidence of the research, you are putting the program, you are doing the good monitoring and evaluation, you are getting the good result, then you are going to generate the more money for the nation. So the more health for the money is there. So these are the some of the interventions that I have said that needs to be done, right? And again, for the health financing decision process, it is not a big issue, but definitely we need to put some more effort that the three dimension of the population, of the cost, of the services, what I have said. So there is a need of establishing the vision in order to translate into reality. Then that should be depending upon the situation analysis of the country, the burden of disease the country has. And then the financial assessment where we stand from the Ministry of Finance point of view, constraint of assessment, what are the constraints that we need to identify, then the strategy of change so that we will hit the target, and the implementation with its monitoring and evaluation, which is the major thrust of the program. Out of this, the SWOT analysis we can do, and we can again have a very good outcome of it, so that it enter into the again visionary, establishing the visionary cycle, and we rectify what the gap we had or what the things we have encountered. Now we, you know, it is all about the constitution, and the constitution has all guaranteed the people's health. So we have a federal, provincial, and the local governance. So the innovative health research financing mechanism should be set up in order to benefit the service, in order to benefit the research, and to finance the research as well. So the syntax, which is at the central level, which needs to be shared at all level, province and the local level. Innovative health research financing includes new ideas and concepts. We have not been able to explore the local level. I have the experience, I am from the village. There are millions of per year, I think, the village I come from, there are 30 to 40 millions of rupees income per year. But where all those money goes? There is something known as Ubhokta Samiti, Consumers Committee. So they make a big plan. Hardly 10% is implemented, 90% is in their pocket with the Ubhokta Committee of all, that consists of all political parties. So this is the where we need to have an innovative approach for the health financing, and we have the capacity. Just a few minutes, ma'am. And I have talked about the taxes. Other than that, at the local level, how best we can have the resources, and it should be the situation-based research. When we talk at the local level, the situation-based research, need-based research, demand-based research, and the operational research with knowledge, attitude, and the practice. If you see different slide over here, different scenario I have. Now we need to have a research at the grassroots level on these aspects, where people's burning their wood for cooking the food. All, you know, COPD. We are trying to NCD, cope up NCD, putting money out of there. We need now the Health Research Council to work on this and bring up with the solution for how best we can replace it, how best we can do. It is not a big deal for it. Likewise, I have shown some of the sanitation issues, and in the Kathmandu Valley, if you see the dust, where we can sue the municipality. Why not? They have been able to do the job. Then they generate the resources for the health, see. Then the financial instruments targeting the financial transaction I have talked about on the banking, we earn a lot of interest keeping in the bank. Why not some should come to the in the levy as a tax for the health research and the health services, diaspora bond for the patriotic discount, tourism and travel related, luxury items, and see some of the innovative financing. I have tried to show through the pictures, which really can be keep in mind at the grassroots level. See the NCD here. That increases the NCD, the butchers. You can levy tax on that. While we can think of the fish catching, we can remove the tax from that and see that. I'm not going to talk about the health insurance because it is one of the major things that people will cover it. So setting up the challenges are the setting up the infrastructure at the provincial level, coming up the good evidence, ensuring the quality of research project ethically cleared from the provincial offices with the situation based, and aligning a structure of NHRC with the structure of Ministry of Social Development and the Human Resources Development Ministry at the provincial level. Thank you. Thank you so much.